Okay, welcome everybody. So today we're going to go over electrolytes. We're really going to simplify everything with electrolytes and make them really simple. Let's go ahead and get started. My name is Dr. Kendall Wyatt, and we're going over electrolytes. A little bit about me. I started out as a paramedic, went to nursing school. Now I've finished med school and I'm just starting as a resident in Charleston, West Virginia. So I do internal medicine. I'm learning internal medicine, and I like to teach a lot of nurses. I think it's a lot of fun. So let's get started with a really simplified topic here. Everything you're going to see today is from the Pygmonic Learning System. Now, all the images you're going to see are from the Pygmonic Learning System. If you've never heard of Pygmonic takes all the fun or all the boring facts you need to know and turns them into fun characters. So if you're learning drugs and diseases, you need to learn warfarin versus heparin and tons of other things, you can learn a war fairy and all about a scene to remember Mondring PTINR and a hippie heron, fun crazy bird, who likes to smoke a peace pipe to remember Mondring PTT. And of course, antidotes and everything else. So it's super fun. You could try it out for free, but everything you're going to see is referenced back usually to the Pygmonic system. So if you have questions, that's about all I'm going to see, but everything you're going to see is really from there. So let's get started really into the nitty-gritty of the topics. So what are we going to go over today? Well, today we're going to be going over really an overview of physiology, just a brief snippet of physiology. Then we're going to talk about some body fluids, and then we're going to go into knowing the normal values, and then those simplified trends of really what you need to know for that particular electrolyte. Super simple and easy, and if you follow along, it's never going to fail you for all the electrolytes you really need to know. Then we'll do just a quick little recap at the end and talk about putting it all together with some more physiology. But if you need to know some more details, you can check out some of the other videos or you can request one. Leave nice comments. Don't leave any mean comments. Nobody likes mean comments. Just keep them to yourself. So first off, let's jump right into fluid volumes. Now, I'm not going to go into great detail on fluid volumes, but here's just a good idea. We know that everything we're talking about is in the fluid part of the body. The body's made up of 60% water, so we can take every human and multiply their weight by 60% and get an understanding that it's all, that's the percentage of liquid or fluid water in the body. Now, when you break that down a little bit more, you know that there's intracellular volume and extracellular volume. Now, this is going to build throughout the entire presentation, but you need to know that of this 60%, you can break it down over here in this next section, and 2/3 or 66% is intracellular, so it's inside the cells. And then 1/3 or 33% is outside the cells. Now, it's just that simple. Inside the cells, outside the cells. And when we're talking about electrolytes, you should know that everything we're measuring on lab values is outside the cells. So that's going to be inside the extracellular fluid volume. But anyway, so when you take the ECF, you can break that down into interstitial fluid, which is 80% of the ECF volume, and then the other 20% is plasma. So we're going to go over this in detail in different videos, but you can take a 100-kilogram person, if you want to make a simple math problem, 100 kilograms, yes, I know, a little on the heavy side, but then you can easily tell it that 60% of that fluid is, or that person's water, and then break down those fluid volumes, 40 liters, 20, and then 16 of 4. So out of a 100-kilogram person, they have 4 liters of plasma. So that's a lot of plasma, of course. Maybe if you're a poor student, maybe you've donated some plasma, but you can see it's not the largest portion of what you've got in your fluid volume, but of course it gets remade. Now, when we're talking about everything today, before we jump into the actual electrolytes, we're going to, at the very end, go back through some physiology of and mentioning some membrane potentials and how everything works. But as we're looking at cells and talking about these things, if you're trying to build on physiology or learn part of physiology, the inside of the cell is going to be inside of our circle here, of our example of our cardiac myocyte, and then there's going to be the ECF volume, the outside of the cell, which is going to be outside. And of course, inside the cell is positive, inside the cell is negative, and outside the cell is positive. So we're going to go over this in the end and really just recap everything we went with, kind of a good example to see how it works and how the channels work with the different electrolytes. The most important thing you need to know are the normal ranges. You can't go into any exam really with just not having those normal ranges on the tip of your tongue. Now, before I talk about the normal ranges, I'm not going to go over every single one of them in great detail. I've ordered them from the smallest one to the largest one. And that's actually how we measure it. It's the total quantity in the ECF volume, the extracellular fluid space. So it's the amount from the smallest to the largest. So let's just look at it. So if we looked at magnesium, phosphorus, potassium, calcium, chloride, sodium, you can see here that I've ordered them from 1.5 to 2.5, then 2.5 to 4.5, 3.5 to 5, and 8.5 to 10. 10.5, and 95 to 105, and sodium's 135 to 145. But if you take those normal lab values, you can actually take this and apply it to everything if you just kind of remember them as in this order, and remember that it's a tiny amount in the ECF volume of magnesium versus a larger quantity of sodium in the ECF than magnesium. So they're ordered in order, and we're going to go through them in that order as well. So we've got all our little fun characters in here to help you remember our magnesium magazine, 1.5 to 2, phosphorus 2.5 to 4.5, and then of course our potassium is our potassium banana, and our calcified cow is 8.5 with the 8 ball to the 10-10. Chlorides are 95 to 105, we've got a little chlorine dispenser, and sodium is our salt shakers for 135 to 145. Now everyone always usually writes in, or they ask themselves, well, my book says this is potassium's 3.5 to 5.2, or my book says 3.7 to 4.9, and those are minor variations. Remember that lab values and their measurement vary between lab, textbook, and everything. On a standardized exam, unless you have an evil instructor, a standardized exam is going to give you a range, a number that's clearly out of range. It's not going to give you a number that's, let's say potassium here, 3.5 to 5. They're not going to give you 5.1 and expect you to notify that as an abnormal lab value. They're going to be very off, so it's going to be like 5.7. They're going to give you a number that's going to be very out of the range so that those tiny little variations aren't going to matter. Unless you have an evil instructor, I know they're out there. I mean, I think it's kind of cruel to do this because they should know that these do vary by lab values. Now, sometimes they'll give you one and they're telling you to test in your book. So just keep that in mind. In a standardized exam, not going to be that big of a deal. So you can put that at ease and remember your set, even if they vary from what we've got here today. But again, when we're going to go over each one of these individually. But the number one thing that's going to trip you up is not knowing these. On nursing exams, you're not given the lab values. On med school exams, they give you a sheet with all the lab values that you can go open up and reference. But I'm going to tell you what, those extra precious seconds of being able to just identify the lab value, not only going to make your test exam easier, but they're also going to help you later on, because then you've really just memorized the numbers. And it's important really to know, especially as it applies straight back to physiology. So here's another example, and one thing that's important to really understand when we talk about all the lab values is that they differ in concentrations. So the composition and percentages inside the cells in the ICF, intracellular fluid volume, is much different than what it is in the extracellular fluid. Well, what does that really mean? Well, here's just a visual representation just to really give you an overview idea. We're going to talk about everything here in the ECF volume as far as the quantities. Lab values are not measured by total body volume. It's measured by the quantity in the ECF and however that appears in the ECF. So you can see that the most abundant one, of course, and by our chart, is going to be sodium as the most abundant, followed by chloride as the second most abundant. Absolutely correct. But if we looked inside the cells, well, the most abundant one is potassium. And of course, right behind that is phosphorus inside the cells. There's just a tiny little bit of sodium, a really tiny, tiny amount. And we're going to go over that again at the very end to just kind of show you how those switch around to create membrane potentials and how neurons fire. So just an easy way. Now, when we're talking about, again, I can't say enough that the lab values just measure the volume in the ECF. So you don't need to try to memorize both. Because you should be able to just understand if you learn one, well, the other one is usually the opposite, as we always teach with lots of electrolyte imbalances. So along with that, you know, you can always go learn them in the Picmonic system. It's the one big thing that I recommend you just absolutely go learn all the lab values at a minimum. Go try it out. It's lots of fun. You can remember the calcium cow sitting down for dinner. You remember the chlorine dispenser pool jumping into the 105. It's a lot of fun to help you memorize a lot of things that literally are just giant lists of things that are often hard to understand. Now, next, I want to really go over simplifying the function. Now, when you simplify the function, we're not saying that this is an always scenario. We're creating a concept of it so that you can apply that concept to everything else you need to know. So what happens in the ECF if you have an increased amount of this electrolyte? That's what we're going to go over today. And if you can write that down and you can memorize that, then if you don't have enough of it in the ECF or a low volume, then it's the opposite, super simple. And that's really how, just to make this a lot easier. Now, this is a giant list, but we're going to go over each one of them individually again. But we can think about magnesium being in charge of muscle relaxation. Phosphorus, muscle contraction, essentially. Potassium is intracellular excitation. And calcium is a neuronal excitation, as well as bones and things in other parts of the body. Yes, I put that in there just because everyone always points it out. Chloride's really in charge of acid base, a big function in monitoring, managing your acid base. And then sodium itself is extracellular excitation. So if we just talked about what's the most abundant one in the ECF, in the extracellular fluid, well, it's sodium. So sodium's the most abundant, and sodium is the most abundant in the ECF, and it's also in charge of extracellular excitation. So you're literally just compounding things as we go here. When we look at potassium, if we simplify the function, is in charge of intracellular excitation. So then potassium is also the most abundant one inside the cells. So it's super easy if you just kind of follow along, and we're going to go through each one of them individually. Now, as we talk about each one of the electrolyte imbalances themselves, we're just going over the simplified function and some basic signs and symptoms. You can. We're going to be making some videos, or I'm going to be making some videos of just each individual one, with more of causes and treatments to really simplify each electrolyte individually. So if you want to go into a greater in-depth thing, you can check those out. We're going to be making them and publishing them over time. Now, when you think through all these electrolyte imbalances, you need to know the normal range. What is the normal value range? You can't miss that. Don't miss that one. That one's the most important. Because if you can't get the normal range, you're going to get a question, and you're not going to go whether it's high or low, and you're not going to whether it's opposite or whatever, because you've messed up the numbers. If you think about the basic function, then it's super easy to then say, well, what are the other systems this is going to affect? And you can think through and understand the concept. And that's the easiest way to learn something and be able to apply it across the board, rather than just trying to memorize one particular thing and then try to memorize too much, memorize too little. You can think through concepts. It's a lot easier. So let's talk about magnesium, our magnesium magazine. So when we look at magnesium, the normal lab value range is 1.5 to 2.5. Now, it's milliequivalents. Now, the units are, you know, usually not something they're going to trick you up with on exams, but you can also easily tell, because there's going to be a few of them that are milligrams a deciliter, and that's because those are special ones. They're not regular plain electrolytes that you're measuring. Now, what's the theme of magnesium? Magnesium is pretty much simplified function, is a muscle relaxation. So if you have extra magnesium or enough magnesium, then it's going to be relaxing muscles, essentially, is how you can think about it. And it has a relatively small ECF amount. So a small amount in the extracellular fluid volume, which also means that if we give it IV, then it could have a pretty significant impact. So if we actually think about what happens if I have not enough and too much. If I have too much magnesium and I have hypermagnesemia, what happens? Well, the muscles are way too relaxed. That's exactly what you see as signs and symptoms. You're going to see decreased deep tendon reflexes. That's the biggest one, right? Deep tendon reflexes are going to be decreased or absent in critical levels. Respiratory depression, because of the diaphragm's a muscle, you're going to see muscle weakness, bradycardia, all across the board. All the muscles are going to be slowed down. They're going to be relaxed. They're just going to be chilling and hanging out like a little magnesium magazine character here. Now, when you don't have enough magnesium, you have a low magnesium, well, what happens then? A low magnesium causes all the muscles to get excited. They're easily excited. They don't excite the muscles, they're just easily excited, where they, and you have muscle excitation, twitching, tremors, increased deep tendon reflexes, and even up to the point of seizures, as well as tachycardia, of course. You can see how those two literally are opposites. There's one, and then there's the other one, and then there's normal right in the middle. So magnesium as a simplified function is relaxing everything. Now, if I took this and I took just magnesium, and I want to apply that to other things, as you're learning just magnesium, you know we can give magnesium sulfate, essentially, right? Magnesium sulfate we can give as a drug. We give that to stop preterm labor contractions. So we're actually slowing that uterus down and say, hey, uterus, calm down. Don't be so excited. Relax and stop contracting. It's not time to push that baby out, right? That's exactly what happens. But how do we monitor when we've given too much magnesium? Magnesium toxicity. What is it? Well, it's going to be exactly the same thing as hypermagnesemia. You're going to see decreased or absent deep tendon reflexes. And that's the sign to say, uh-oh, too much magnesium. Stop, withhold, decrease, notify, whatever you need to do to know that that's too much magnesium. Super simple. You can learn the electrolyte imbalance, you can learn about giving the drug, and you can learn all the side effects just by kind of simplifying all of this function and making sure you know that normal electrolyte value. And of course, because magnesium is a small ECF volume, it's very possible to majorly change that electrolyte with just small doses. So it's something we always have to monitor. You can go inside the Pigmonix system. These are just examples of the Pigmonix. You can go in and learn. It'll play the audio for you in a condensed form and teach you all about it, as well as the antidote for hypermagnesemia. One of my favorites, calcium gluconate, or our calcified cow with the little glucose, just because I think he's a weird one to have to remember. So along with that, it's super easy. And when you think about, there are some things called that are laxatives, that magnesium laxatives, right? So magnesium laxatives, what do they do? Well, they relax the GI so that you can just let it all out. And that's kind of exactly how it how the system works, so that you can kind of think things through in this simplified function. Let's move on to the next one. Phosphorus. Phosphorus is a tricky one, just because it's there's a lot more things to kind of understand around it. So I'm not going to harp on this one a lot. But essentially, it's 2.5 to 4.5 milligrams a deciliter. And it's milligrams a deciliter because there are phosphorus and phosphates in general. So we're measuring all the phosphates and with that phosphorus, just the way it can be compounded, because it's PO4-3. I can't remember right now. I always mix up the two numbers at the end. But the thing of it is phosphorus has a very small ECF amount as well, and it's primarily responsible for muscle contraction. So if we think about somebody who's in renal failure, who can't create a lot, you know, they can't create a bicarb buffer, so then they build up a lot of phosphorus, and what happens? They end up with muscle twitching. They end up with problems along with hyperphosphatemia. And you can kind of think through those and lots of examples. But phosphorus isn't as commonly tested except in scenarios of those diseases. And so we talk about hyperphosphatemia again, muscle excitation in general. And we've got our little 2.5 with our 4 fork and our 5 hand to help you remember the normal lab value. And of course, if we don't have enough phosphorus, then you're going to think of muscles are going to be a lot low weight. They're going to be too relaxed as well. It's not something we see without other diseases like renal failure and whatnot. Now, one of the highest yield ones is potassium. Potassium at 3.5 to 5 milliequivalents a liter. You got to know it right away. You can't miss potassium. It's just such a high yield question. It's going to be across the board. If you didn't get something on potassium, I would be shocked. But potassium is a volatile electrolyte. It's kind of like the little weak electrolyte, I say. There's lots of drugs that can make you excrete too much potassium. But potassium is a small ECF amount. It's 3.5 to 5, really, really small. So I always think of the small ones as the sensitive ones. We don't want to hurt their feelings. So we've got our potassium banana in here. And when we think about potassium, it's in charge of intracellular excitability. Well, that's because most of the potassium in our body is inside the cells. And what do you need to remember about potassium itself is that potassium is very cardiac sensitive. Cardiac myocytes are especially sensitive to influxes and changes of potassium. And it's also the thing that's going to kill you first. So if you think about anything with when you think about a lot of your questions and prioritization questions and what do you need to do first, well, just think about what's going to kill you first. And one of the things that's going to be a serious detriment to the patient is a potassium abnormality because of the risk for arrhythmias. So how do we identify those arrhythmias? How do we know, what are the arrhythmias we know with a low potassium and a high potassium? Well, if you have too much potassium, we know that so the insides of the cells are going to be excited. That means they're probably likely to fire more. So you see, you actually see a very strong repolarization because of the exchange of the potassium, and we see a very characteristic classic increase, a peaked, tall peaked T wave. So PQRST on the ECG, on that T wave, you're going to see a big, big, tall peaked T wave. It's going to be abnormal. You usually can see it, and it's going to say, oh, there's a tall peaked T wave. Wonder what that potassium is. It might be a little high. So you get a patient in renal failure again who can't excrete things out, then you're maybe, if you look at that ECG, you're going to see that tall peaked T wave, and you're like, wow, they're probably just building up all kinds of toxins that they can't get rid of, especially potassium. So what about the opposite? What about hypokalemia? So not enough potassium. Well, not enough potassium. We're going to see a lot of paresthesias. Paresthesias are those pens and needle feeling. But you also see a flattened T wave. So you see exactly the opposite of a tall peaked T wave. Now you can also see something called a U wave. PQRST, and then a little U wave, which is, again, just because of that repolarization abnormality, because of membrane potentials, they can't balance in the cardiac myocytes. They're very sensitive to changes in potassium. So we're going to, separately, we've got to help you with ECGs, we've got some ECG stuff. It's all out there. You can go see those and really see how those T waves and things change. So here's our Pigmonix on these. You can see lots of things. along with hyperkalemia, you're going to end up with a lot of weakness and paralysis type problems in the skeletal muscle. You also see kind of a hyperactive diarrhea symptoms. We've got our weak drooping muscle in here. But of course, here's a tall T-man on his T-wave to help you remember that. There's a good example right there, drawn in that tall peak T-wave. It's usually not quite that big, but it's a bit exaggerated here to help you out. So, and then of course, the hypokalemia is exactly the opposite. A flattened T-wave, a U-wave, we've got our U-wave guy here. And of course, you see a lot of constipation, of course, our corticon toilet. Now, calcium is one that's tough. It's tough because it has a lot of complex parts that you may not need to really understand, but I'm going to explain the basics, then add on to it. So you might need to listen to it again to kind of put it together. So calcium is 8.5 to 10 milligrams a deciliter. Now, what do we use? What's calcium for? Yeah, it's in the bones, in the tissues of things. Yes, fine. But remember, only our lab values measure ECF volume. And calcium as an electrolyte in the ECF, its function there is a lot of neuronal excitability and stabilization of channels, especially cardiac myocytes as well. So, the cardiac myocytes there, that's how we get our refractory period so that you can't have a tetany essentially in a heart. And I'll talk about that again in a second. So neuronal excitability. So what happens is, if we think about lab tests themselves, how do we measure calcium? So calcium lab tests are completely different. When you think about calcium, remember it's measured in milligrams a deciliter. So that's measuring the whole calcium, that's complex calcium and everything that's there, not just the electrolyte itself. And that's really important as you're looking at a lot of the lab values and you see these signs and symptoms that go along with it. When you're looking at a total calcium, that's the total calcium that's bound in the ECF. And that's measured in three different parts, three different types of calcium that the lab test itself is measuring. We could measure free electrolyte, ionized free calcium, but that lab test is much more expensive and it's not necessary for to be able to understand what's going on in the symptoms. So when we look at lab tests, we've got a pretty consistent breakdown. We've got the ionized free calcium. That's the Ca2+. That's the free, active, floating free calcium. It's there that's able to actually to bind to the cells to cause actions. And that's about 50%. But 40% of the calcium is super important to know that it's bound to protein. Now, what is the most important protein in the blood and that we need to know that, it's so important? Albumin, that's right. If you said albumin, then you got it right. Albumin is the most abundant protein. And albumin is really like, I feel like it's your best friend that you invite over. They just carry everything around. It's a really important binder. It carries lots of drugs, but it specifically also carries calcium. Now, when we look at one of the things, before I say that, the last one is chelated or essentially calcium as a complex. So you can have a calcium bound with something else, and it's a calcium something, right? And it's bound together as a molecule, and that's floating around in there as well, but it's not active until it's split free. And that's about 10%. So most 50% of all the calcium is free floating and can actually cause signs and symptoms. But let's think about protein there for a second, because this is important. When you think about that protein that's bound in, and again, albumin is that major protein that it's bound to, where is albumin made? Well, albumin is made in liver, right? Where almost all the proteins, liver. So a patient who has liver failure or a liver problem where their liver is not functioning correctly, they may not be able to make enough albumin. Or if you have somebody who's starved in a severe starvation state, they may not be able to make enough albumin. So if you don't have enough albumin, then what happens? Well, you may end up with a total body calcium that looks on a lab test as low. So the calcium may look like it's 6.5. And that's why we use a cute little handy-dandy equation to actually take that and look at the albumin and say, oh, well, it's 80%, blah, 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 looks great. That's a normal calcium. That's why you're going to see a lot of practitioners look at that and be like, oh, that's fine. That's a normal calcium. It's a corrected calcium because our lab test has only measured that ionized free, and our body is only keeping that ionized free calcium level at the normal homeostasis amount to not cause signs and symptoms. That's where you can really see that, and it's a common confusion point that a lot of people write in about. So just like we have here, we calcium correct with albumin levels in a what appears on a lab test, the total calcium in the ECF, which actually isn't low when it's corrected. So if you correct it with the albumin and then it's still low, then you're going to see a lot of signs and symptoms with your patients. So if it's acute and it's acute low calcium with what is that? Oh, what's the procedure you need to monitor after that? What is it? Oh, thyroid surgery, especially a thyroidectomy where you may actually remove the parathyroid glands. And that's where we'll talk about all those details of each individual one in the actual lectures for each electrolyte. But you can think of there, unless it's acute, you need to make sure you're checking the albumin. So what happens in hypocalcemia and hypercalcemia? Well, our basic, where did I go? Oh, so neuronal excitability. Here we go. Neuronal excitability is that simplified function. So we're going to excite cells with calcium, that ionized free. So, but why does neuronal excitation, why does it, if we have hypercalcemia, why does it cause decreased muscle contraction? Why does it cause muscle weakness? Well, the neuronal excitation is essentially like a stabilizer. It's the one that keeps everything from going crazy. That's really how you have to think about it, instead of thinking more about the exact one. So it's a little tricky to understand. And again, we're coming back to a lot of membrane physiology and free ionized calcium. But with this, I like to just use this to something that I know. And if you can remember hypocalcemia, because there's a couple things with hypocalcemia or hippocal here that cause a lot of classic signs and symptoms and super high yield questions that you're going to see a lot. Hypocalcemia, that means we're going to end up with a lot of easily excitable muscles because calcium's not there to kind of stabilize those membrane channels and say, hey, calcium, it's okay, you can calm down. So if we don't have enough calcium, we end up with diarrhea, excess diarrhea. So the smooth muscle in the GI is going nuts, excreting everything out. And you end up with tetany. Well, tetany of skeletal muscle, because calcium essentially is in charge of the refractory period in the heart, which isn't there in that skeletal muscle. So we can see two classic signs and symptoms with hypocalcemia. What are the two classic signs and symptoms that you need to know? What are they? You should be easy. I got one of them right here. Well, one of them is Trousseau sign. Now, Trousseau sign is essentially that drawing into the fingers, and sometimes they'll draw it all the way in. If the classic question is if you were to put a blood pressure cuff on their arm and pump it up, you would see that drawing in and see Trousseau sign. And then the other one is Swoboda sign. I always end up having to stop to pronounce it, Swoboda sign. So Swoboda sign is actually when you tap on the facial nerve of a patient, what's going to happen, and when you tap on that facial nerve, bum, 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 what's going to happen is they're going to twitch. The facial nerve muscles are hyperactive or excessively easily excitable. So they're going to twitch. So you're going to see they're twitching in there. You're going to see a twitch. They're just common questions that you're going to see out there. But there are some examples where you're going to see a good Trousseau syndrome in real life. So I'll talk about that next. So with hypercalcemia, it's sort of, you're going to have way too much calcium than that ECF amount. So what happens is you end up seeing a lot of decreased muscle contraction and constipation, essentially. Now, if we came back to hypocalcemia, now remember we talk about the fluid levels amount, and we say, what if a patient, and you tie in lots of concepts here, if you have a patient who's hyperventilating, a classic hyperventilator is going to be breathing way too fast. You could check the acid-base lecture to really get this too, because I tie it in there. If you breathe way too fast, you're going to blow off a lot of CO2. CO2 is acidic, so then you're going to make your body very alkalotic. And if you have respiratory alkalosis, what happens is you're breathing and you're blowing off CO2, making your body alkalotic. It's very fast, it can happen very quick. But one of the classic signs and symptoms you see are these drawing ins of the hands, and that's because of a shift of the ionic calcium. So the ionic calcium then, because your blood is alkalotic, it binds more to proteins like albumin and creates a transient hypocalcemia, which then causes Trousseau sign. And that's why you see, if you've ever seen anybody hyperventilate, they say, I can't feel my hands. I have all these pins and needles and my hands, I can't, I'm paralyzed. And they're actually dig in because of Trousseau sign, a transient Trousseau sign because of that transient hypocalcemia with metabolic or respiratory alkalosis because they're blowing off all the CO2. You can kind of you don't need to be able to tie in lots of things like this at certain levels, but it's good to be able to tie in concepts with something you know, with something you don't. So you can check out the picmonics. In here, we've got two different ones to help you remember hypocalcemia as well as hypercalcemia, and you can remember lots of things. So when we have a high calcium level, we want to then get it, you know, get rid of it, and we can give lots of things, diuretics to be able to decrease the calcium as well as some binders and whatnot. Now with sodium, if we want to think of simple again, simplify things out, just make it easy. Sodium normal value, 135 to 145 milliequivalents a liter, perfect. So it's mostly, if we thought about simplifying, it's for extracellular excitability. So extracellular, so it's exciting things from outside of the cells. Extracellularly, great. But what's happening with sodium is it's weird because it's really sensitive to fluid balances. So when we talk about fluid volumes of cells and you talk about the osmoles, and the concentration of solute in a solution. Sodium is the one that literally, sodium, salt. Well, sodium, salt is always going to try to diffuse out to create this homeostasis amount. But what happens is you can have transient hypernatremia, and we see a lot of hypernatremia, so an excess amount of sodium in each liter of your fluid when we have dehydration. So if I'm dehydrated and I have a decreased amount of extracellular fluid because I let it all out of my skin or I peed it all out, whatever it is, you have a decreased amount of fluid, you end up with a hyperconcentrated amount of sodium. So what happens? Well, you end up with hypernatremia and hypernatremic type symptoms. The first one you're going to see, of course, is you're thirsty because your body wants to get that volume down to a normal amount. And of course, you're going to see dry and flushed skin as well. Now, you're going to see some other things with muscles and whatnot, but I don't want to go into that because it just gets more confusing because so many of them involve muscles. Now, with hyponatremia, so you have a low fluid volume, you can have excess amount of fluids as well. So you can end up with excess amount of fluids, so you can't have that extracellular excitation, and you end up with some cramping again, problems with muscle firing, and then just lots of confusion and weakness. Important points with hyponatremia is a low sodium volume. And things with sodium levels need to be corrected very slowly. It's very important because if you do, what happens if you have hypernatremia? Well, what happens is your body's trying to create that normal sodium level, so it's going to try to pull the fluid levels out of the cells and into the extracellular fluid. The body will try to do that and correct itself, so you can't correct the sodium, low sodium too fast because you can actually then force a lot of fluid in and cause something called central pontine myelinosis, which I'm not going to go into right now. But sodium is an interesting one because you can have it because of a couple different reasons. And of course, lots of signs and symptoms you can go learn inside of our picmonic to really get those down. Now let's just put it all together really quick. Let's do a quick review and understand what we're talking about with each one of these and really kind of think through each one. So when we talk about cellular exchange, I'm not going into rapid details of the physiology, but I want to talk through it again so you can think about some of these concepts and how they go together. When you move things across the cellular membranes, there's diffusion. So diffusion just is, if I've got 100 over here, and I've got 2 over here, and I've got a membrane, well, there are pores to let me take some of the ones over here and put them over on that side, and everything, they're going to both want to be equal. In a perfect world, if there's an easy membrane for it to go through. Then we have active transport, where you actually have energy using, active means energy, it's energy to transport one to the other because of certain membrane potentials or whatnot. Anytime that this perfect homeostasis of everything that's working normally gets off kilter, and one is there's too much up here or too much inside, if there's too much in the outside, then it's going to be trying to easily more force its way into the cells because of that high concentration. So the cells have to work harder and pump electrolytes via active transport one way or the other, which causes a lot of the signs and symptoms that you're going to see. So when we think about this, we've got here's our same image again. We see our ECF volumes. The number at most abundant one is sodium, and then the ICF, the most abundant one, is potassium. So those two actually are a good cellular exchanger. So they actually put things inside the cell and back out normally. And let's use an example of our cardiac myocyte. So we have a cardiac myocyte here, a heart cell. Inside of a normal heart cell, it's normally, it usually has a negative charge. Now, people always get confused when we say there's lots of potassium inside the cells, and those are all our K pluses. How come the cell itself is negative. I would just, one of those things just to understand without going too much into membrane potentials themselves for this particular video. But if you just remember that there's lots of potassium inside the cells, how can you remember that there's lots of potassium inside the cells? Well, the easy way I remember is, or I used to remember, before I did, back in the day, I guess, if we have a crush injury, you have a patient who has a severe crush injury. I mean, I crush my whole arm and it just smashes all the cells. Or I have a burn injury where I burn lots of cells and they just explode. What is the one electrolyte that you're super worried about? It's potassium. That patient is at risk for hyperkalemia because there's lots of potassium inside the cells that were a high volume inside that said, hey guys, we're free. Now we're all going outside into the blood, being reabsorbed in the extracellular fluid. That's why those patients are at risk for hyperkalemia, and that's how you can remember that there's lots of potassium inside the cells. Now, cells have a negative charge. Outside the cells in the ECF volume, there's usually a positive charge, and the most abundant one there being sodium, so lots of sodium. Well, how do we remember that? Remember those lab values again, 135 to 145 on our sodium. Now, normally there's a normal thing going on with the cells here where we've got lots of our potassium moving inside the cells to basically go in and keep that nice negative charge. And it's a lot of because potassium itself has a membrane potential, minus 92, I think. And sodium has a membrane potential or action potential of a positive number. Calcium also positive. So when you look at the membrane potential thing, if you understand physiology, you'll get that. But what's important to know is that there needs to be energy. If this is normally negative, then there needs to be energy in things to help this what we call the sodium-potassium ATPase pump. Now, it's ATPase because ATP means energy, adenosine triphosphate, but ATPase means it needs to break down ATP, ACE. ACE always means enzyme. So we're breaking off an adenosine triphosphate enzyme. It's binding to this, and it's able to pump in 2 potassium, but it has to move out 3 sodium. So it's able to keep this membrane membrane potential there and actually keep everything up and keep everything in homeostasis. Now, along with the cardiac myocyte itself, there are channels inside of a cardiac myocyte. And here's just our little channel. I just threw this in here. And the one thing with the, so that the cells don't just run amok and go crazy, these channels essentially are stabilized by calcium. And that's why calcium is the good stabilizer drug. If you have a patient who's having problems, we can give them a calcium or a calcium and medication to stabilize the heart as well, because it's a stabilizer of membrane channels, especially in cardiac myocytes. Again, some of this is really simplified, and it's a lot of, there's membrane physiology goes along with it, so you can watch a membrane an action potential video to really understand the difference here, and then come back and put this together if this isn't a review for you. So it's definitely something that it's good to understand, and I recommend it. So I'll see if I can't make a different video to really understand this a little bit more. So after we've reviewed everything, the biggest thing is to remember to review all those topics. Make sure you know the lab values and think of a simplified function for each. Yes, I know it's not a cure-all every single time, but for 90% of most of what you need to know, it's going to be right there, and it's going to be the best thing to use as a basis. And understand that, yeah, there are always little scenarios here and there, but as you're learning things in the beginning and you're really just trying to get a grasp of it and make sure you remember it, it's so much easier to remember a theme and put it all together. So you can, in the comment section, there'll be some playlists that actually you can go and learn all the electrolyte imbalances and memorize our Magnesium Magazine Man, relaxing, to remember hypermagnesemia, super relaxed. I recommend Picmonic for sure. It's a great product, not just because I work there. And I'm going to be making a study guide, which has a lot of this in a printed form for you. But just don't forget those normal ranges. Know the basic function of each one of them, and definitely get it down. My name's Kendall Wyatt. I appreciate you coming. Make sure you subscribe to the channel. Click the little subscribe button, which is right there. And check out some of my other videos. Most importantly, just share with your friends, and we appreciate it. I'm Kendall Wyatt, and always, as always, we appreciate you watching. Send nice comments, maybe some cookies, and good luck studying. I don't know why everybody gets so mad when I just take drinks in my cup. I love this cup. I get so thirsty, my mouth gets dry, I talk so much. Some people say I talk too much, I don't mind.